Howdy, how's it going? My name's Davy Chappie, and it seems that my predictions were correct in that a whole new slew of subclasses are getting churned out of the Unearthed Arcana Warehouse, this article hosting subclasses for the Bard, the Cleric, and the Sorcerer, and like with all the Unearthed Arcana releases, it has become my dav-given duty to talk about them. So, as always, keep in mind that a lot of this is just my opinion, so if you feel like I'm way off base with these UA videos, feel free to play your games however you want. And real quick, I'd like to give a brief shout out to my new patrons this month. Mador, James, Nick, Darla Ramirez, Michael Cruz, Jaren Howe. It is because of you that when I saw a moldy sandwich laying on the side of the road, I didn't stop to eat it. But with that out of the way, let's begin. So, starting off with the Bard, we have the College of Creation, an outerplanar scholar that has become aware of the clearest, purest form of magic, the Song of Creation. With this song, creation bards can affect the world around them on a much more drastic level, an ability that manifests in the outrageously cartoony way of having floating music notes around you. These music notes work in tandem with your bardic inspiration and are given out to your allies at the same time, and they can be used to either explode in a wave of sound around the inspired ally, give them temporary hit points, or completely reroll that use of bardic inspiration. Pushing the boundaries of the Song of Creation even further, you can spin life into mundane objects to get them to fight for you, and beyond that, a College of Creation bard can even use the power of the Song of Creation to will certain items into existence for as long as they maintain the song, so long as the item costs less than 20 gold per bard level and is only up to large in size. And if you maintain the song for one whole minute, then the object becomes semi-permanent for an amount of hours equal to your bard level. As a concept, I'm very much in love with the College of Creation. It's so cool to think of this as a mage that was able to reach so far back into the very idea of magic that they ended up hitting the end of the thread, as in the very point where it all began. My only gripe is that every other bardic subclass gets two features at third level, but this subclass only has one, and while the nodes of potential are cool, they're not so powerful that they make up for the lack of features. The performance of creation is very fun to think of possibilities for, and I don't mind it not being a combat skill because it's just too cool, and I can't wait to get to level 6 with my creation bard so that I can spin a little ditty, and then me and my newly animated life-size gold statue of Mark Wahlberg in anime form can go on kicking ass right after. Shifting focus to the next topic, the Unity Domain Cleric teaches us that life sucks, so you gotta spend it with the people who suck less. Pulling the power of gods such as Athena, Heimdall, Eldath, and Rao, the Unity Domain embodies the platonic attachment that people have for each other, from spouses to siblings to friends. Unity is the unspoken word that binds us all together, and you're gonna use it to murder goblins. As a cleric of the Unity Domain, you can bond two creatures together so that they perform better while they're nearby each other, and they can later use this bond to shield the other from harm. You can use your channel divinity to absorb the damage from one ally and spread it across all your friends so that everybody can feel the pain. You gain the potent spellcasting feature, and your final ability strengthens your bond power so much that the range becomes near infinite. And if one of the two bondmates goes down, the other gets a massive power boost for either 1 minute or until the fallen partner wakes up so that they can avenge their teammate's defeat and restore their honor, including getting advantage on everything, resistance to everything, and the ability to shake their partner awake by gifting them a box of heart-shaped hit dice. Now, I really like most of what I'm reading here, but the one big gripe that I have is that I think the duration of the bond should be reduced to 1 minute. Adding 1d4 to something once per turn isn't a super big deal, but once you hit 6th level, you're basically giving free resistance to all damage to two of your allies for an exceptionally long time. Yeah, I know that you have to give up your reaction for it, but let's be honest, there aren't many things that reactions are good for, and none of them beat free resistance to everything. Like, make it a bonus action, at least, or perhaps reduce the effectiveness from all damage. The Bear Totem is already broken, we don't need two of them. Even at 1 minute, the power is still a bit obnoxious, since 1 minute boils down to 10 rounds of combat, but it at least means that the cleric will have to be a little conservative about using the ability instead of just throwing it up before entering a dungeon and letting that be that. Especially considering that they can use the feature again if they burn a spell slot, it just means that they won't be caught completely with their pants down even if they've used the power already. Hopefully, after that, this domain will once again find unity. And rounding out this batch of archetypes comes the strangest addition to D&D in a while, steampunk, or more specifically, the Clockwork Soul, a brand of sorcerer that went into the lawful land of Mechanus and decided that a fantastical land full of Modrons, gears, clockwork, and brass being completely canon to a D&D setting was a really cool idea. As a clockwork soul, you hail from this land, and so your entire being is now caught up in the clockwork, giving you strange, otherworldly features that help distinguish you as a primal force of the law. And looks aren't the only thing that Primus has gifted you, because as you look out at the world through a pair of brass goggles, you gain abilities such as being able to balance out roles by canceling out any advantage or disadvantage that they had. You can spend sorcery points to ward creatures against damage. You can channel the spirit animal of the clock to somehow make it impossible to roll lower than a 10. And your final ability lets you summon the pure forces of law and order for a split second to massively heal everybody, completely repair everything, and end all spells of 6th level or lower in a 30-foot area around you. Overall, this last subclass confuses me, and not because of the thematic idea of it being a steampunk character in a largely fantasy setting. There are guns and dinosaurs in this world too, you can get over it. But it confuses me because the mechanics sort of teeter-totter between the theme of balance and mediation that it's trying to convey. The negation of advantage and disadvantage is cool, but the warding ability is similar to the abjuration wizards, and it's honestly a little better. better, which shouldn't happen when you are an abjuration wizard. The ability to turn rolls into a base of 10 is super good, because being able to make random parts of the game almost entirely reliable is crazy, but even then I'm not bothered by it. And then you have the ability to essentially reset damaged things around you to their base form. All these abilities are totally cool, but I'm ironically having a hard time seeing how they link together. Also, like the Bardic subclass, this one is missing a first level feature that all the other ones get, although I am happy to see that they're continuing the trend of giving the sorcerer bonus spells. The point that I'm trying to make with this rambling is that of all the subclasses presented in this Unearthed Arcana, the Clockwork Soul Sorcerer looks like it might have a few gears loose. But that'll about do it. I hope you enjoyed this video. Be sure to leave a like, comment, subscribe, ring the bell to summon the Geometry Goblins, and maybe support me on Patreon so that I can afford to find some unity of my own. But yeah, Davy out.